Inland Empire. Tell me, who are you, dead man? Success. The hanged man says, I'm gone. I can see you're gone, but who are you? I'm a joke. Look at me. There's nothing funny about you. There's nothing funny about jokes, either. Who were you when you were alive? A killer. A mother, bleeper, and a killer. I have another question for you. Go ahead, Kobo. What is happening? What do you mean? I'm talking to you. It's the power of your black frothy liquid starts bubbling on his lips. Imagination. Go ahead. Ask me more questions. You love questions. Why do I love questions so much? Because you're a copperoonie. Look at all of them go. Do you want more questions? Yeah, give me questions. Here you go, you loony. Where have you gone? Into the wild pale yonder. Where's that? In the past. Way out in the west. Why do I feel like I've forgotten something terrible? Because you have. Is my name Rooney? Hell no, you're no Rooney. I do strike myself as a Rooney. No, you don't. Between you and me, your name is probably Harry. Enough. You can come back and look into this face any time you want. Ask me your little questions, freshen your memory, create associations, remind yourself of your mortality, Copolopo. So how do we get him down? Kim stops to think, then checks his notes. Are you sure we finished the preliminary examination of the cadaver? We might miss some of these things once he's down. Step back and have another look first. Squint and take a step back. As you narrow your eyes, the monster before you blurs into a violent mess of green and pink. Visual calculus says, this is a trick. You've done it before. Pink is where the blood settled into the first hour's post-mortem. You can use it to see if the corpse has been tampered with. Does his position at the time of death match the discoloration? Observe. Only the lower extremities are pink with a dash of blue. His fatted hands, thighs, and his neck just above the noose. The rest of the corpse appears dark green in the cold spring air. His face and hands are pink. Thighs, too. I see it. Kim adjusts his glasses. His neck, too. The lividity goes right up to his chin. We have good, well-pronounced discoloration here. Relax your eyes. The monster comes back into focus, an explosion of color, coursing with dark marbled veins. His stomach appears pregnant with something. Black liquid streams down his thigh and onto his boot. So, what do you think? Cover my nose. Something is coming out of him. A pool of blood and feces has eaten into the frozen mud below the man's feet. Purged liquid is dripping into it, drop by drop. Kim says, the victim appears to have contained no more than half a kilogram of digestion at the time of death. Cuno says, the hell he's saying? Cuno says, talking about crap. Maybe he went to the toilet sometime before death? Maybe. He doesn't really want to dwell on it too long, Kim. I think he was upright after death. His hands, feet, and neck are discolored. Agreed, Kim says. He points to the belt, especially on the neck. The belt acted like a tourniquet, keeping the blood in his head. The hypostasis supports a hanging. Could it still be he was moved after death? There's always a chance. We should check for ligament marks in his neck to see if they're in tune with the belt. We'll have to get him down first. He's beaten up. See the bruises? I do. Most of them are post-mortem. Maybe even all of them. The delinquents have made our jobs harder with their little sport. Kuno says, stop talking in riddles, coin slot. Kuno says, he means you screwed him up real good, Kuno. The girl yells, screwed him up brutal-like. I think he's dead. I agree. His personality is no longer a part of this world. Totally dead. This one, number two, is referring to one. Deadity dead dead dead. Kim says, "Dabba doop doop dead." He says without a hint of melody, not one muscle in his face moves. Back off and catch your breath. But there was no breath to catch, only the cadaver filling the air and your nostrils. He slowly rotates before you, decomposing. I have something I need to know, corpse man. Of course. You have questions, don't you? The power of your imagination is at your service. I hate you. You stink and you're boring. Do I remind you of someone? Encyclopedia says, a child born with Mahler's disease, harlequinism, grown up miraculously. A baby affected with harlequinism. You sure wriggled out of that one, Coppolini. Come back later, Capo. Amuse yourself with my frank manners and my memento mori features. If possible, also see me in your dreams. Yeah, the preliminary examination is done. Let's get him down from there. Level up. Kim says, the steel reinforced belt presents a unique challenge. I thought of chain cutters, but I don't see a good angle of approach to the belt. Rhetoric says he doesn't actually think the challenge is unique. He thinks it's frustrating, annoying, and harder than he thought. Kim says the cadaver is a good 1.2 meters up. Neither one of us can reach the belt without assistance, and even if we do, there's the question of cutting the airship strength material. We could saw the branch. Climb up there and saw the branch? Yeah, it seems dangerous. There has to be a less risky way with less falling down off trees. Can someone else do it? Someone else? He pauses. You mean like the police? Rhetoric says, what was that about? Processing then. Weren't they supposed to take care of the boots? Why don't they help? Can't the boys from processing take care of this? No. Why? Think of the boys from processing as murderers, only instead of people that murder crime scenes. Processing is a wrecking crew. They know how to commission off items and how to work the incinerator in the morgue. I know it's hard, but I assure you, the others won't come to help us, and we have a growing sanitary concern here. We need to get him down fast. Maybe we could shoot him down? Kunoa says, yeah! The enthusiasm is unrestrained. Bang, bang, time, pigs! Shoot his head off! The lieutenant remains unaffected. How? Visual calculus says, where the buckle ties the rope to the branch, that's a good spot to aim. Point to it. There. The buckle holds the belt together. Where? Kim corrects his glasses. Ah, yes, I see. If the shot hits that there, might be a chance to release the belt. Cuno says, now we're talking. Entertain the Cuno with some crap. Cuno says, they'll miss. The pigs will miss, Cuno. Take the shot, Lieutenant. What's the worst thing that could happen? I'll blow his head off. Take it! Take the shot! Cuno says, yeah, take the shot! Cuno wants some more of that crap. Kim, silence, with his elbows sharp, the lieutenant unzips his jacket and produces a lightweight firearm. He drops a paper cartridge in the barrel, separates the scouring stick, and gives the cartridge 5 tucks. Let's see if Kim is anything like Twitch from Sam and Twitch. Twitch could give that. Twitch could make that shot. Encyclopedia. That's a Kajil A990 Armistice mass-produced muzzle loader. Aesthetic, frugal, one of the most common firearms in the world. Kim then steps back and assumes the fallow test position, taking aim. The corner of his eye twitches. His finger is on the trigger. Shoot that mother down. Cuno says he's gonna mip. The kid's voice is drowned off in a shrill blast that echoes off the walls of the surrounding tenements. A cloud of smoke slowly parts in the air as the lieutenant steps back and says to himself, God damn it. Cuno says, idiot, mukapaz, stuff. Cuno says, Cuno could have hit it easy, but then Cuno's not handicapped, is he? Try again, maybe? No, we're lucky as it is. We didn't break anything, and the victim remains uncompromised. He looks around at the windows overlooking the yard. Any more mistakes could put us in an unfortunate position with the locals. We have eyes on us. I didn't do us any favors with that. It's okay, man. Kuno's sorry, too. Kuno feels sorry for the binoclard. The lieutenant doesn't say a word, just looks at the gun in his hand. What now? I have to say it's beginning to look unlikely we can get him down without assistance. Maybe we could ask for help from the harbor? I was really hoping we wouldn't. The Union appears to be suspects in this case. It seems like a dangerous route to go down. Logic says, I would really prefer if there was another way. These people might have an agenda. Yeah, wait, let's reconsider. But what other options? The corpse twists on the belt like chicken on a skewer. Can I have the gun? I should try. It's bad as it is. Us shooting firearms like punks? He pauses and shrugs and proceeds to load the pistol at. Can I make that shot? Go ahead, I'm not stopping you. Just don't lose it. The piece shines in the outstretched hand. Cuno says, they only have one gun. This is the sorriest pair of pigs Kuno's ever seen. Take the gun. Cuno says, yeah, take it, you bananapoika. Take it and shoot yourself in the mouth. Feel the weight first. The cold piece of bakelite and gunmetal is surprisingly light. Your finger fits right through the guard, instinctively resting on the trigger. The hell you waiting for, Cuno? Tell him to shoot himself in the mouth. Point the gun at the belt. The buckle comes into focus in your sights. You stand with your feet planted firmly in the ground and your left hand supporting your gun arm. Cuno says, why don't you just shoot yourself in your mouth? She hisses. At least you won't miss. Point the gun at Cuno. Shut up. Or what? You gonna screw me? Her voice is almost a whisper now. You wanna screw me, pig? Is that what this is about? I have very low chance of getting this. Close your left eye first. Your field of view narrows. The branch slowly moves, becoming entirely two-dimensional. The metal buckle glimmers, catching the noon light as the corpse slowly rotates. Visual calculus says the slow movement of the branch in the wind and your shoulders directing the gun sink up, dancing hypnotically. Okay, I improved it a little. Pull the trigger. I missed this part. Failure. Cuno says, look, he's crying. You gonna cry now, Fagari? A plume of white smoke erupts from the barrel. Your hand goes numb from the explosion. With your ears still ringing, you lower the weapon to see what happened. You missed a belt, but hit the corpse straight in the chest. Bits of rib cage protrude from the skin. No blood, only a murky sludge dripping down his belly. The sudden stink makes your eyes water. Cuno says, Oh, that's what you say. He's gonna cry. I knew it. What a murku. There's something wrong with your weapon, Lieutenant. It keeps missing. He took it back. The armistice is sufficiently precise, officer, especially at close range. He takes his sidearm from you and holsters it. Cuno says, It's not the gun's fault you can't shoot. It's your pig hands. Cuno says, Pigs don't have hands. They have, like, hoofs or something. Cuno has hands. He displays his little fingers. They're pink. Cuno can shoot that crap down for you. No. That's preposterous. We're not giving you the gun, kid. That's preposterous, she whines mockingly. What are you, a Earl? Kim says, We still need to get him down somehow. His tone is growing tired now. The stench makes him turn away from the corpse. But how? The bad way. The way I didn't want us to, he sighs. By asking the harbor for help. They have the tools and the men. If they put him up there, they can take him down, too. But won't it be dangerous? To ask the suspects for help with the victim's body? To be indebted to Everard Clare? Very much yes, which is why I would have preferred us to handle this ourselves. Clearly we can't. I'm not reading that. What's wrong with being indebted to Everard Clare? He's dangerous. He's a dangerous and corrupt man, and we cannot predict what he will want from us in return. Cuno says, Yeah! Don't go being someone else's bitches. You're Cuno's bitches. This kid is crazy, man. How do we get inside the harbor? From the gates. By negotiating or fighting. I'm unenthusiastic about fighting, he looks around. Well, we can try to find some secret third path. It's unlikely, though. To the gates. Let's negotiate, Rhetoric says. Let's get to it, then. We still got this. Yeah, Cuno, screw him up. Should we talk to this kid some more?
Fuck this Cuno kid!
The boy turns to you. He doesn't care. Empathy. Figure out what's going on with this kid. Success. It's not Cuno, it's Cuno S. Interesting. How? Cuno S is by far the worst of the two. Cuno has no problem being near you, but the other hides behind the fence, afraid for her life, like she's done something. Something very bad. She came up with that psychopathic scheme of screaming for help before. Cuno just wanted to talk to you about his name. Cuno S was the one who wound him up and directed him. Also, Cuno hasn't stopped talking to you, even enjoys it from time to time. When you talk to the other one, it's like talking to a cornered animal. She only hisses. All in all, Cuno respects madness. You cannot hope to outdo her on that front. You must win yourself a few minutes with him alone. Act on it. Try and separate them. Cuno, psst. How are you whispering about? He whispers back. He's whispering, too. He's going with it. But watch what happens. Cuno says, How are you faggots whispering about? She puts extra stress onto that word, expecting it will make you uncomfortable. Cuno says, If Cuno wants to whisper, he's gonna whisper, okay? He turns back to you and hunkers down. Let's whisper, pig. This is it. You've got him. But be careful. You can still screw this up. Don't make Cuno look bad in this. Phew, I might get glad she's out of her hair. She's screwed up. She's not screwed up. He raises his voice, but then lowers it again. Everyone's screwed up. Stop judging stuff. Wrong move, Empathy says. But he's whispering still. You haven't lost him. Just don't mess up again. Or you will. There are no guarantees here. Cuno, listen to me. She's trying to control you. We gotta get you out of here. It's okay. He straightens his back and turns to Cuno S. Pigs trying to pit us against each other. Not gonna let him do that. That's it. You let him off the line. That was a bad, manipulative thing to say. You should understand. I got you this far. I couldn't get you all the way. Well, the only other thing to say was that she was crazy, which is basically what I had said the first time, which didn't work. Cuno says, tried to screw my Cuno. A giggle, malicious and gleeful. She pulls herself up higher on the fence. Tried to screw my Cuno away. Me and Cuno are tight. We ride for life. Try again. Try once more to figure him out. Find a way to connect with him. Failure. He's on your crime scene, bossing you around, and he's been here for some time, too. This is where he hangs out. You have to get more out of him. He could be useful. Failure, though. Still got more options, even though we failed. Cuno, you must have seen all kinds of things throwing stones here. When I helped the RCM bust a murderer? Hell no! He bursts out loud, laughing. What are you, mentally handicapped? Cuno, they almost made you a snitch now. Ease off. See, Cuno always takes the bullet over the hammer. He nods, big boy style, incredibly proud of himself. He'd rather die than work with the justice system. Where's the rest of this guy's armor? Cuno doesn't give a crap about the armor. How come? Cuno's gimp's got one big thing wrong with him. He's a mutant. A mutant? Look at him. He points to the body. Growth hormone crap. He's a giant. The armor's too big for any man. He drills his temples with his fingers in some strange, aggressive gesture. Cuno doesn't give a crap about that freak armor. Cuno threw that stuff away. What do you mean by threw it away? Cuno tried to get the helmet on. It was too big. Performs a kickoff on the imaginary helmet. Cuno kicked that crap in the sea, rugby style. Means nothing to Cuno. You threw it in the sea? Yeah, that crap means nothing to Cuno, he repeats. Cuno doesn't give a crap about material stuff. Cuno's a monk. A monk, yeah. You want to screw on someone about that armor? Go screw the mustache union crap, the jolly troubadour at the gates. What do you mean, troubadour? Yeah. You know that jolly union cow bleep? Came around talking about cows or some crap. Came around pretending like he cares about cows. So yeah, he's the one you want to talk to. He's crazy about that armor. Coming here pretending like he likes cows, trying to catch a peep at Cuno's armor. Go to the gates. Ask him yourself. Drama. Curious, my liege. Why did Cuno feed you this information? And you're just telling me this out of the kindness of your heart, Cuno? Yeah, Kuno's doing charity today. Cuno Day. Cuno feels sorry for you two loser pigs. Cuno's doing pity now. Still, seems suspicious. He may have it in for that guy. Or you may be paranoid. There's also a possibility, sire. Well, drama is very polite to us. There are contusions all over his body. Did you do that? Hell are you talking about? What is this contusion crap? He grabs his head like it's suddenly hurting. Okay, we gotta dumb it down a bit. He says you're stupid, Cuno. They want to make you stupid again. A contusion is a bruise. I'm talking about the marks your stones left on the corpse. Oh, did Cuno make your crap sniffing harder? Obstruction of crap sniffing? He lets go of his head, suddenly feeling better. This is Kuno's kingdom. Cuno rules here. Perception says, You hear the lieutenant hum. You're testing Kuno's patience here. Get lost. More questions about the crime scene. That's locked now. Yeah, the kingdom of Cuno. The hell do you want with it? The ladder. Have you ever climbed it? Look at that crap, he screeches. You trying to get Cuno killed? So you'd say that ladder is unclimbable? How does Cuno know? Cuno's not an acrobat. The lieutenant takes a quick note in his notebook. It's a trap, Cuno. Don't climb it, Cuno. What's in the greenhouse over there? Dunno, he shrugs. Kipped-ass gardener used to work there. Encyclopedia says Kipped is a pejorative term used to describe people of South Seminese or Areopagite descent. It used to be a common first name among the Areopagites of Lilmara. Not so much anymore. Hold on, the gardener used to work there? Yeah, that's what Cuno said. She couldn't handle the heat, so she took off. Cuno can take it. He fills his lungs with the rancid air. His eyes get a little watery. It's nothing to Cuno. You mean the young woman by Whirling in Rags, that gardener? Look, Cuno doesn't explain crap. Cuno just says crap. He looks you in the eye and nods, as if agreeing with himself. Rhetoric says, yeah, her. Logic says, what was she doing in the greenhouse in March anyway? What kind of gardening is done in March? Encyclopedia says, a fish is sometimes used to fertilize the soil a few weeks before planting something. Maybe she was preparing the garden beds? I should ask her about that. New task. Ask gardener about gardening in March. Yeah, it seems suspicious, Logic says. You don't like things being like that. Suspicious. I was wondering about that trash container. Don't be wondering about Kuno's crap, pig. I got a very strong hunch there's something of importance in it, something I must find. How does Cuno care about your hunch? That's your crap, you figure it out. Cuno, there was a stack of Eternite back there, pointing to the shack. That's just some crap roofing gimps left behind, lazy dinks. Inland Empires, there it is, that strange feeling again, as if there was more than meets the eye about that pile of roofing material. Yes, some crap gimps left behind. Were those gimps suddenly raise your eyes? Left-handed? How are you talking about? Cuno doesn't know what handed gimps they were. Cuno S says, trying to get you to talk gimp, Cuno. Don't talk. You can't hide it. I see without vision, with my inner eye. Cuno says, inner eye? Hell are you talking about? He loses cool for a moment and starts yelling, ask me a normal question, pig. They're trying to make you feel stupid, Cuno. You glance again at the roofing material in front of the shack. Yes, you should go back there. Yeah, whatever. Cuno doesn't give a crap. He spits over his shoulder and then looks back up at you. Cuno doesn't care. Alright, it really wants me to go back and look at this. Hold on, though. I got stuff. Oh, I can level up. So rhetoric goes to 8. Oh, my sever affair is horrible. So I got this instant photo of tattoos. Lieutenant Kitsuragi snapped this photo of the hanged man's tattoos. It displays the intricate web of blue lines stretching across his torso. You have to admit, it looks quite cool. And we got a bunch of crap. Ask Gardner about gardening in March. The young woman with the wheelbarrow at the corner of the Whirling and Racks told you that she had to take a break from gardening because of the cadaver smell. But what if she was lying? After all, what kind of gardening is done in March? Getting the body down? Somehow make it so that the bloating corpse isn't up there anymore. Shoot it down or ask for help. Do something. You're a cop. Access the harbor and ask for Everard Clara's help. The victim's tattoos. You have a photo of the hangman's tattoos. Maybe someone can decipher them, tell you what they mean. You should probably talk to about two people. Probably talk to about two people about them for this. Ask around about the tattoo's possible meaning. Two people, exactly, huh? In order to succeed, one, the body has to be down, two, autopsy has to be finished, and Kim has to be absent. He wouldn't approve. This will be devilishly tricky, so don't beat yourself up if you manage to send the body to the processing without getting hold of the boots. Get boots off victim's feet. Run the number on the victim's armor. You discovered a serial number on the victim's ceramic armor boots. Run the number using Lieutenant Kitsuragi's shortwave in the motor carriage. Uses Kim's shortwave to run the serial number. Where's the rest of the armor? The hangman's armor seems to be missing. Find out what happened to it. The kid throwing rocks at the corpse seems to be a good place to start. Ask him about the body first. Alright, I did ask him, and now go to the harbor gates. Ask the jolly mesk about the armor. Okay. Alright, so we really want to look at this again. Is that a person up there? Huh. Why am I looking at this pile of the roofing material? Failure. Because it's nice and orderly, well-laid pallet, easy on the eyes. It reveals no secrets at this time. What is this? It's nothing. Okay. We can't get there yet. All right. Let's check out this thing. Now that we have a key for it, right? Oh, my voice. I'm losing it. Open the padlock with the key. With a well-oiled crack, the lock pops open. It should now be possible to simply raise the lid. Inland Empire says, don't. Maybe you shouldn't. Didn't I just have a premonition that there's something in there? There is, but you won't like it. Sweat forms on your brow. Your hand is still on the lid. Open the lid. The smell of rotten food rises to greet you. You see soggy cartons, dirty rags, and organic waste. We're just in time, the lieutenant peers in. This hasn't been emptied for over a week. Look under the boxes of carton. You see milk, an egg rest with one broken egg in it, some pasta wrapper. Picking up the soggy packages, somehow feels familiar. A box falls into pieces in your hands. Batiste Soleil cereal. There are plastic pasta packages below and turbo noodles. Nothing of note, however. Pick up the rags. Among the threadbare kitchen towels, something catches your eye. A pair of denim trousers? Grab them. As the legs of the slime-covered jeans begins to unspool from the garbage, a rank corpse smell fills the air. The victim's clothes? Kim says. The lieutenant smells them. Cadaverine odor is faint. If these belong to the deceased, they were removed when he was still in the early stages of decay. The lieutenant produces a black plastic bag marked evidence from his pocket. Drop them in here, officer. Bag the trousers. Kim quickly searches the jeans. Guitar mark blue jeans, pockets empty, or emptied. He wore them with a belt, too. A wide belt. The loops appear stretched, but... He looks into the container. The belt is missing. That's it. Do you see anything else in there? I have another bag here. Something slimy catches your eye. Reach for it. A drab long-sleeved shirt, olive-covered, appears from the food waste, dripping with pus. Oh, my God. Bag the shirt. This is a military-type overgarment. Kim says. No label or serial number. This is the kind of rib-knit shirt that's worn over light armor to conceal it in an urban scenario. He nods to himself. Anything more? The rest of the rags are just kitchen variety waste. A yellow old mug catches your eye, but other than that, a thrown-out towel, a mug, that's all. New task. Who put the clothes in the trash? Kim says, all right, we should go to Gart again and ask if he knows who put the clothes in the trash. It could be as simple as someone from the hostel cleaning the yard, or that one. He nods toward the red-haired boy behind him. I'd advise against confronting that force. You think someone from the Whirling might have been involved, maybe? Not really. All we know is the victim's clothes are in the trash, the lid was locked, and this establishment had the key. It's just a small loose thread. He's advising us against questioning? Or saying that they put... against questioning, I guess. We need to ask the kids who put them there? Cuno says, the hell's he on about, kids? The one behind the fence yells. You hear that, Cuno? He thinks you're an infant or something. Kim says, see? Okay. The lieutenant nods and looks back into the trash container. Search the food waste. It's just organic waste, cold and slimy on your hands. Apple and potato peels, mostly. Unidentified sludge and the occasional chicken bone thrown in for good measure. But hey, Inland Empire says, nothing, it's nothing. Nothing more to see here. What's this? What? A blue piece of plastic sticks out from the apple peels. It's shiny. Looks like the corner of something. Pick it out. Damaged ledger. Something larger. A clipboard. A blue plastic clipboard with moist papers hanging from it. They look badly damaged, but you can still make out forms and notes written in a man's handwriting. Officer, is that your paperwork? No, it can't be. Yes, it is. Look. He points to it. This plastic has the RCM street grid on it. You've even got an autopsy form. A miserable-looking slip of paper sticks to the board. If you don't mind me asking, how'd this get in the trash? Ugh. I think I didn't want to be a cop anymore, so I threw it away. Well, Kim doesn't know what to say. Lucky we found it. You should take stock of what remains, just to be sure some has not been made it into the hands of the RCM's adversaries, organized crime and the like. There might have been police secrets in your notes. Okay, I'll do that. New task. Read your ledger and name the case. It would also not hurt to start taking notes on the case. He peers into the trash, where soggy cartons and rags stink uninvitingly. Now tell me what your eagle eyes see. Or are we finished? The mug. I'm getting that mug, too. You pick out a broken mug with an oddly racist depiction of the yellow man frolicking in saffron. An antique? Only in its social sensibility. Take the mug. The man briefly glances at the mug, then returns his sight to the trash. Close the lid. The container sounds like a muffled gong. That's one thing off the list. The lieutenant sounds relieved. I think we got it all. We got more stuff. Read your ledger and name the case. This case needs an official name. Go to your inventory and interact with the damaged ledger to give it one. Finding the right line may take some time. Sounds like it's something with a bunch of reading, so I'm not going to go into that yet. The victim's clothes were in the trash compactor out back, neatly folded. Who could have put them there, and why? Only the Whirling staff was supposed to have the key. Ask Cuno if he knows anything about the victim's clothes in the trash. Ask Guard if he knows how the victim's clothes got in the trash. Yellow Man mug. This broken-eared mug somehow made its way into the Whirling and Rags dumpster. It depicts a man of Samaran descent frolicking in a field of saffron flowers, buck-toothed and grinning feeble-mindedly. It seems to be a cheap knockoff of some colonial-era antique. This is the ledger you found in the trash. It's full of notes, written in a man's dense cursive. Have a closer look. Maybe it can be salvaged to start keeping notes on the case. I'll be doing that next episode. Over here, Baconator. Time for launch. Okay, gonna call in an episode here, guys. We need to talk to Cuno, I guess. Again. Read the ledger. Go back, talk to the restaurant manager. Go talk to the gardener. We've got our stuff, yeah, cut out for us. Thanks so much for watching. See you guys next time, and always seek adventure.